It started out as a routine mission. Find yourself in a remote area, in enemy territory, days from friendly forces. You have no supplies. Your mission suddenly has changed to survival and evasion from hostile forces.
Anybody hurt?
I hurt my arm.
Can you make it a little farther?
Yeah.
We'll take a look at it later.
Yeah.
Where's the pilot?
He's dead. I got his dog tags.
Did anybody see Sergeant Wagner?
He jumped out the other side, went off in the other direction.
Okay. We're gonna move about 3,000 meters that way. Put some distance between us and the enemy, then we're gonna see what we're gonna do.
Separated and unable to link up with the rest of the group, Sergeant Wagner will be required to survive and evade without the assistance of others. No soldier is immune from being in a survival and evasion situation. There are many things that can determine whether you will live or die. Water, food, shelter, injury. But the most important factor in surviving in the wilderness is your will to live. Your desire to survive can overcome the discomforts and fear of even the most difficult conditions. Psychological defeat will kill you long before your body succumbs to the elements. There is a survival attitude, and it can make or break you. From the start, hope for the best and prepare for the worst. Immediately size up your situation. Are there injuries to be treated? What equipment do you have? Where are you? And where are you going?
I don't think I can move another step.
Keep it down. So we're gonna have to get rid of that insignia. Too shiny.
Okay.
Let's take a look at that arm, sir. Doesn't look broken. Keep an eye on it.
Let's take a look at your vest, see what we got.
Come on, where's your vest?
It's in the aircraft, sir. I had it draped over my seat and I didn't have time to get it.
Survival is a very stressful experience. understanding the physical, mental, and emotional stresses that can destroy your will to live will help you overcome them. When you have sized up your situation, plan your survival strategy. Planning helps you get your situation under control.
Radio's broken. We'll have to work around it. Let's figure out where we are. Take a drink while I look at the map. Gilmore, how about helping Mr. Williams with some water?
In hostile territory, every move you make must be planned to conceal your presence from the enemy. Security is always your top priority.
Yeah, we were generally heading south on a 190 heading. Judging from our last checkpoint and our compass reading now, I put us about here. Friendly forces are here, across the river. That's where we have to get. And we can't go near any of the roads. I'd say we're looking at about 6 or 7 days on the move.
7 days?
Shouldn't we get back to the aircraft?
No, sir. That's the last place we want to be. That bird belongs to the enemy now.
How are we going to live out here for 7 days? We don't have any food. I don't even have water. Come on.
Look, we'll find water, and food isn't really necessary right now. We'll leave at sundown and move till first light.
Why don't we move during the day? It's easier to see what we're doing.
Yes, sir. It's also easier for someone else to see what we're doing. This terrain is okay for night movement. Now, Gilmore, bury your helmet. Sir, better start camming up. Then we're going to lie down low on the ground and face each other.
Fear is natural in a survival situation. Injury and death are real possibilities, especially in hostile territory. Fear is healthy. It makes you cautious and keeps you from making reckless moves. But fear that turns to panic can kill you, especially when you're alone. Control panic immediately. Your survival depends on it. Panic keeps you from making good decisions. It can destroy your will to live. Your personality will be critical to your survival. How do you react to adversity? Can you look beyond immediate discomfort and focus on your goal of surviving? Can you keep going when things seem intolerable? Survival stresses can test even the strongest personalities. Well-trained soldiers have died because they couldn't withstand the mental and emotional stresses of survival. In a survival situation, your most important personality trait will be your ability to keep going under difficult conditions. Understand from the start that discomfort will not kill you. However, the psychological effects of discomfort can get the best of you if you let them. The desire for comfort must be forgotten in a survival situation, particularly when you're evading hostile forces.
This looks like a good hide site. There's good cover and it looks pretty dry. We'll stay here till tonight. Stay low. No unnecessary movement or talking. What are you doing?
Leave your boots on, sir. Sergeant, I've got blisters on both feet.
Yes, sir, but we have to be ready to move fast.
But my socks are wet.
Leave your boots on, Gilmore.
We have to rest. You can't get exhausted. Lie down in a wagon wheel, heads in. Camouflage as well as you can with leaves and brush.
Ah.
We'll rotate security an hour at a time. I'll take it first.
Gilmore, you got it next. Sir, you take it third.
Listen and look. If you hear anything, wake me up. If somebody snores, squeeze his arm. That'll wake us up without scaring us.
8 major factors can seriously affect your will to survive, if you let them. They can overwhelm you to the point that you give up. By recognizing the 8 enemies of survival, you can begin to control them. Pain is an enemy of survival. Pain itself is not harmful, but it can make you so uncomfortable, your will to survive will erode. Understand the source of the pain and treat what you can. Then recognize that you can tolerate the pain. Taking pride in your ability to withstand pain will help you tolerate it. Thirst and dehydration can weaken you physically and mentally. Dehydration can erode your will to live and, if it becomes serious enough, can kill you. An important rule is to drink when you can. Conserve sweat, not water.
I'm not thirsty.
Drink anyway. You can be dehydrated without feeling thirsty.
I am hungry, though. What are we gonna do about food? We can't go 7 days without eating.
Tomorrow morning, we'll find a safe hole-up site where we can look for food.
What's wrong with here? We must be a couple miles from the crash site.
This is just a hide site. Not safe enough to move around.
Hunger can seriously affect your morale. The physical effects of hunger are lack of energy and weakness. Prolonged time without food can lead to starvation. The psychological effects of food deprivation can be just as serious. Adult humans can survive without food for up to a month, but not eating for several days can weaken you to the point that you want to give up. Understanding that you can survive on only a little food will help you to tolerate hunger.
Now I wish I hadn't eaten that candy bar I'd stashed in my vest.
Fatigue is a powerful enemy of survival. It can lead to mental mistakes and carelessness. Many things can cause fatigue: overexertion, hopelessness, boredom, and frustration. Pinpoint the cause of fatigue and correct it. Cut back on activity or change your activity to relieve boredom. Heat and cold are strong enemies of survival. Heat weakens your body, but you can acclimate to heat. In extreme heat, seek shade and move only at night. Drink as much water as you can. Cold can weaken your willpower and your reasoning ability. Extreme cold can kill. Find ways to combat cold before it threatens your survival. Boredom can also affect your will to live. It can make you impatient and lead to careless actions. A good survival plan will help you relieve boredom. Keep sight of your goal to survive, and boredom will not get the best of you. Loneliness can weaken your will to survive. Isolation can lead to despair and helplessness. You can combat the feelings of isolation. Focus on living. Becoming self-sufficient in your survival will help overcome loneliness.
We'll head on a 74-degree azimuth for approximately 1,500 meters to the third checkpoint. This little hilltop?
One enemy of survival can lead to others. Be alert to the stresses of survival and combat them early. A sign that stress is affecting the will to live is a passive reaction and withdrawal from activity and from other people. If you or one of your party becomes passive, showing no interest in what needs to be done, take steps immediately to reverse the process.
Then we go on a 350-degree azimuth for approximately 900 meters and we'll look for a hole-up site. We should be able to make that by first light. Sir, you follow me. Gilmore,
You bring up the rear. Keep your eyes and ears open. Gilmore, repeat what I just said. What are we doing tonight?
What difference does it make? I'm just following.
What are you gonna do if something happens to me, Gilmore?
We're not gonna make it anyway, Sergeant, with or without you. I'm so hungry and tired now, I don't even want to think about moving.
Well, you gotta think about it, Specialist. You are gonna cooperate. Now, we are gonna make it. We just have to use our heads. We can't let it get to us. Do you understand?
Yes, Sergeant.
You can overcome the psychological, emotional, and physical stresses that you face in a survival situation. The key word, survival, contains the tactics to use in fighting the enemies of survival. Size up your situation. Undue haste makes waste. Remember where you are. Vanquish fear and panic. Improvise. Value living. Act like the natives. And learn basic survival skills. Constantly size up your situation. Continue to check your equipment, your water supply, and your surroundings. Follow your plan, but be ready to make adjustments as your situation changes. A change in weather may alter your shelter plans. An injury may change your movement plans. Enemy presence could mean changing your route or suddenly leaving your hide site. Security must be your first priority.
Okay, we're gonna move in about 10 minutes. I want you to carefully get up, move out of the hide site about 5 meters, and then get down. I'm gonna sterilize the hide site. As soon as I'm done, we can move out.
When you're under the kind of stresses you encounter in a survival situation, it's easy to think that any action is better than doing nothing. But acting in haste leads to carelessness. You can lose equipment, suffer injury, get off your route, or reveal yourself to the enemy. Plan each move, even if enemy presence forces you to react quickly. Plan where you are moving and why.
Remember, I keep the map in this pocket. The compass is here. If something happens to me, get it out. Okay, let's move.
Knowing where you are and how your location relates to the surrounding terrain is a basic principle every soldier should follow. Guard against the natural tendency to let someone else do all the navigating when you are not in charge. Constantly orient yourself. Always know who has the map and compass. Know where you are in relation to your last known location, friendly forces and enemy forces. Fear and panic will be your greatest enemies. Knowing what to do in a survival situation will help you control panic. You will gain self-confidence knowing that you can take care of yourself under stressful survival conditions. Be prepared to control the panic of others in the group. One person who gives in to panic can put everyone in jeopardy. Teach others survival skills. You'll increase their confidence and improve the survival odds of the whole group. Be ready to improvise. Americans are so used to having everything readily available, we don't often have to improvise in our daily lives. But when you must survive with little or no equipment, you will have to improvise to get many of the things we take for granted. Shelter, water, and food. Your imagination could save your life. When improvising, however, don't forget that security is still your top priority.
I think this will be a good hole-up site. It's off the line of the drift. It's a good distance from the road. And that thicket provides good cover. We should be able to move around here pretty safely.
Is there any chance we'll find some water here? I'm pretty thirsty.
The map shows a stream about 150 meters from here. We'll find water, then we'll rest. Same security rotation as yesterday.
The key to survival is to value living. People in survival situations have made terrible mistakes, such as moving in the hot sun of the desert, but their desire to live was so strong, they survived. Other people equipped with skills have died simply because they gave up mentally and emotionally. Before you find yourself in a survival situation, observe the people in the area. What do they eat? What do they use for shelter, for heat? Where do they find water? What animals are in the area? Animal life can give you clues to survival, but be careful in using animals to guide you. They can eat some plants and insects that are harmful to humans. Also, the reactions of animals can reveal your presence to the enemy. In many survival situations, not knowing basic survival skills for the terrain can kill you. If you don't know how to find water in the desert or shelter in extreme cold, your chances of surviving these environments are slim. Knowing survival skills increases your confidence and will reduce panic. The time to learn basic survival skills is now, before you find yourself in a survival situation. They could save your life. The psychological and physical stresses of a survival situation are constant. They can change or intensify. Things will go wrong. You must constantly be aware of your psychological state and of the moods of the people with you. The will to live can falter even when things seem to be going well. Panic can recur, and frustration and anger can surface quickly.
Not bad, Sergeant.
Is this all there is? I don't feel like I've eaten anything.
This will be enough to keep us going for 2 more days. Then we'll hole up again later.
2 more days? How are we going to do that? All we've eaten is one little rabbit in 3 days, and now you're telling me it could be 2 more. Forget it.
Just think how good MREs will taste when we get back.
If we get back.
No. When we get back. I mean that. When.
The stresses of survival can produce thoughts and emotions that can weaken your will to survive. Your will to live will be your most important ally in any survival situation.
Friendly forces should be on the other side of the river. Let's lie low today and move across tonight.
Remember, the key word, survival. It contains the keys to combating the enemies of survival and maintaining your will to live. Through even the most difficult, uncomfortable, and frightening survival and evasion experiences. Maintaining a strong will to live could mean the difference between life and death.
It started out as a routine mission. Now you find yourself in enemy territory, maybe days from friendly forces. You're not prepared for a long stay in a remote area. Suddenly, you have a life and death mission, surviving while you evade hostile forces. As a soldier, you could find yourself in a survival situation at any time. Knowing some basic survival skills could mean the difference between life and death. First aid, water, shelter, food, fire, and signaling are the key elements of survival. The priority of these elements of survival will depend on your situation. As soon as you realize you are in a survival situation, stop and size up your situation. Make a survival plan. Set your priorities according to the things that are most important to sustaining life in your circumstance. Size up your situation for all survival elements each time your situation changes. Changes in location, weather, injury, and level of fatigue can affect your priorities. In a hostile survival situation, avoiding enemy detection will always be your top priority. Every survival move must be made in a way that doesn't reveal your position to the enemy. Water is a top priority in any survival situation. Water is especially critical in desert environments. Even in temperate climates, a human cannot survive long without water. Dehydration can set in after only a short time. You can be dehydrated without feeling thirsty. The lack of water can affect your judgment and weaken your will to live. In many survival situations, you will need to obtain water. Security is always your first consideration in deciding when and how to procure water. When possible, look for water while moving at night. Try to get to your hide site with full canteens. There are many ways to procure water, even if streams and other bodies of water are not available. Vegetation is a good source of water. Solar stills built around vegetation collect condensed moisture from the vegetation, but they could reveal your position to the enemy. A transpiration bag is a solar still that collects water in a clear plastic bag tied around living vegetation. To make a transpiration bag, place a large plastic bag over a living limb of a medium-sized non-poisonous tree or large shrub. Poisonous vegetation will produce poisonous liquid. If you have a piece of tubing, small straw, or hollow reed, insert one end into the mouth of the bag before you tie it. Tie off the tubing. Seal the bag opening at the branch. Tie the limb down to allow the collected water to flow to the corner of the bag. Of all the solar still methods, the transpiration bag yields the most water. It can be used on the same shrub or branch for about 3 days, collecting the same amount of water each day. A vegetation bag or above-ground solar still works like a transpiration bag, but with cut vegetation. Fill a clear plastic bag about half or three-fourths full of green, non-poisonous vegetation. Place a small rock inside. Tie off the bag, inserting tubing if available. Set the bag with the mouth facing downhill on a sunny slope. The rock should be at the low point of the bag. Condensed water will collect around the rock. Loosen the opening of the bag to drain the water or suck water directly from the tubing. A seep hole in a damp area or an area where a stream has dried up will collect water available below the ground surface. Dig a hole in the muddy area deep enough for water to seep in. The hole will fill with water. Sediment will settle to the bottom of the hole. Remove the water carefully to avoid mixing the sediment. Dew from the grass can be a source of water. Early morning is a good time to collect water from dew. If security permits, tie rags or a piece of clothing to your ankles and walk through the grass. Wring the moisture from the rags into a container and repeat the process. Water with heavy sediment may need filtering to make it more palatable. You can filter water by letting it stand for 12 hours. You can also pass it through a filtering system. Put several inches of filtering material, such as sand, crushed rock, grass, charcoal, or cloth, into a container, such as a trouser leg or a hollow log. Charcoal will remove foul odors. Pour water into the container and let it filter through into another container. The filtered water should sit for 45 minutes before you drink it. You can locate water by paying attention to your surroundings. Creeks and streams are often found at the bottom of hills. Drainage water collects in low-lying areas. Animals can lead you to water. Birds fly at dawn and dusk. When they fly straight and low, they are looking for water. Animal trails in a V pattern can indicate routes to water. Rainwater collected in clean containers is safe to drink. Sap extracted from certain trees and vines also is safe to drink without purification, but cannot be stored. Use iodine tablets, iodine drops, or chlorine ampoules to purify water. All water from ponds, streams, lakes, springs, and swamps should be purified to prevent illness and disease. If you don't have purification tablets, boil your water. Never eat ice or snow. Do not drink seawater, urine, or blood as substitutes for water. You will dehydrate your body even further by using these sources for water. Shelter could be important to your survival. A good shelter could greatly increase your survivability time. In Arctic and desert climates, shelter is essential. Even in more temperate climates, shelter can be a comforting psychological lift. It can strengthen your will to live. The type of shelter you build will depend upon time, tools, and the material available. Generally, it is not desirable to build a shelter in a hostile survival situation unless weather conditions present a greater danger than enemy observation. Build your shelter to protect you from the predominant wind. In the woods or tropics, don't build shelter beneath dead tree limbs or coconut palms that could fall on you. Locating your shelter near water is good if you're fishing. The disadvantages of locating near water are bugs, lower nighttime temperatures, and flooding. A field expedient lean-to is a good shelter to protect you from rain, but it could give away your location. Begin the lean-to by tying a pole about 7 feet long between two trees, waist to chest high. Place poles about every foot against the horizontal support. These poles are the beams and should be about 10 feet long, an inch or larger in diameter. As with all lean-tos, place the beams backside to the wind.
crisscross samplings or vines across the beam to create a mesh effect so that the waterproofing material does not fall through. Cover the framework with brush, leaves, pine needles, or grass. Start at the bottom and work your way up, as you would for shingling. Lay straw, pine needles, or grass inside the shelter for bedding. For added comfort in cold weather, a fire reflector wall will reflect heat back into the lean-to. Don't build the wall too close to your shelter, because fire could spread to the shelter. This debris hut is a warm, weatherproof shelter, but it is large and could give away your location. Determine the basing size of the shelter by marking about 8 inches on each side of your shoulders. Mark 8 inches on each side of your feet and about 1 foot past your feet. Connect all the marks on the ground. Start a debris hut by leaning a ridge pole against a tree or stump. The pole should be 2 or 3 feet longer than your body. Place sticks, also called ribs, against the ridge pole with the bottom end of the ribs on the lines. Put a layer of brush across the ribs to create a mesh effect so the insulating material does not fall through. Pile leaves, pine needles, or grass until several feet thick. The more insulating material, the warmer the shelter. Put down a layer of sticks to keep the insulating material from blowing away in the wind and rain. Put about 1 foot of insulating material inside the hut. You can also add a framework door or pile insulating material at the entrance and drag it back in with you to close the entrance. You have now created a loose-fitting sleeping bag. Shelter in the desert can be critical. You will need shelter to protect you from the life-threatening sun. This below-ground desert shelter can reduce midday heat by as much as 30 to 40 degrees Fahrenheit. 2 layers of ponchos or covering, placed about 18 inches apart, create an insulating airspace. This shelter requires more time and energy than other shelters. Since your physical activity will make you perspire and increase dehydration, build it before the heat of the day. A swamp bed protects you from the wet ground and swampy terrain. 4 trees or poles with a frame of poles attached should be set high enough off the ground to allow for high water and tides. Leaves and grass make a soft sleeping surface. You need fire to purify water and prepare food. Fires also are used for warmth and for keeping dry. Security is your first consideration in using fire. In an evasion situation, fire should be used only for survival. Fires create smoke, which can be seen and smelled from a long distance. The light of a fire can be seen day or night. The remains of a fire also leave distinct evidence of your presence. Fire needs air, heat, and fuel to burn. Avoid laying your fire on soil with high peat or humus content. An ample supply of wood should be nearby. Clear away dry brush and scrape surface soil from the fire spot. Clear a circle at least a meter in diameter to keep the fire from spreading. Gather combustible materials before you begin to build your fire. You need tinder, kindling, and sustaining fuel for a fire. Tinder is dry material that ignites with a minimum of heat, even a spark. Kindling is readily combustible material which can be added to tinder when there is enough flame to ignite it. Sustaining fuel is less combustible material that burns slowly and steadily once it is well ignited. There are several methods for laying a fire. One fire lay is the cone or teepee. Arrange tinder and a few sticks of kindling into a cone or teepee shape. As the core burns away, the outside logs fall inward, feeding the fire. Add sustaining fuel when you have a good fire started. A lean-to is another way to lay a fire. Push a green stick into the ground at a 30-degree angle into the wind. Put a handful of tinder deep inside the lean-to stick and lean kindling against the stick. Add more kindling, then sustaining fuel as the fire catches. For a cross-ditch fire lay, dig a 3-inch deep cross in the dirt. The ditch gives the fire its draft. A large wad of tinder and pyramid of kindling in the center of the cross form the heart of the fire. When you are evading the enemy, use a Dakota fire hole. It is the safest way to build a fire. It conceals smoke, flame, and odor. To build a Dakota fire hole, dig a hole large enough for the fire under a large spreading tree. On the upwind side of this hole, poke or dig a large connecting hole for ventilation. The smoke will dissipate in the tree's vegetation. Keep the dirt from the hole nearby to be used if you need to put out the fire quickly to avoid detection. This soil is also used to camouflage the hole before you depart the area. Use dry wood that produces little, if any, smoke, and keep the fire small enough that the flames don't rise above the hole. Don't make the fire any larger than necessary. If rocks or logs are available, and if you have time, build a fireplace wall. The wall reduces flying sparks and protects the fire from wind. Be sure to leave enough draft to feed the fire. Also, avoid wet or porous rocks in a firewall. They can explode. You can start a fire without matches. A magnesium fire starter, which is easy to carry in a personal survival kit, ignites tinder quickly. You can start fires with other equipment you might have on your LBE or survival kit. Small strands of steel wool ignite when you connect them to the terminals of two radio or flashlight batteries. Gunpowder in the fire lay will act as tinder in igniting a fire. If you are moving, you will need to navigate. Even without a compass and map, you can orient yourself with some simple navigation techniques. When there is enough light to create shadow, shadow tip navigation will show you where north is. Place a stick approximately 3 feet long into the ground where it will cast a shadow. Mark the end of the shadow with another stick or rock. After about 15 minutes, mark the end of the new shadow. Draw a line between the two marks and extend the line about 18 inches. Place the left foot on the first mark and the right foot on the line. You will be facing north. A watch with hands can help you navigate. In the northern hemisphere, hold the watch horizontally and point the hour hand at the sun. A thin stick can be used as an aid to line up the watch and sun. Bisect the angle between the hour hand and 12 o'clock. This would be the north-south line for standard time. If your watch is set on daylight savings time, use the midway point between the hour hand and 1 o'clock to find the north-south line. If there is any doubt about which direction is north, remember that the sun rises in the east, sets in the west, and is due south at noon in the northern hemisphere. In the southern hemisphere, point the 12 o'clock mark toward the sun. The midpoint between 12 and the hour hand is the north-south line. If you have only a digital watch, estimate a clock face with the correct time on it and use it as you would a watch. You can navigate on a clear night by the stars. In the northern hemisphere, use the North Star as your compass. Locate the North Star by finding the Big Dipper first. The Big Dipper looks like a giant ladle in the sky. The two stars forming the outer lip of this dipper are the pointer stars. They point to the North Star. Mentally, draw a line from the outer bottom star to the outer top star of the Big Dipper's bucket. Now, extend this line about 5 times the distance between the pointer stars. You will find the North Star along this line. The North Star points due north. In the southern hemisphere, the Southern Cross will identify south. The Southern Cross is a group of 4 bright stars in the shape of a cross tilted to the side. If you extend an imaginary line 5 times the distance, you will find a dark region called the coal sack. Locate a landmark on the horizon directly below the coal sack. This landmark will point you south. You can improvise a compass to find north. A piece of needle-shaped ferrous metal or a flat double-edged razor blade and a piece of non-metallic string or hair will make a compass. Magnetize the metal by slowly stroking it in one direction on a piece of silk or nylon. Running metal carefully through your hair or running a magnet along metal also will magnetize it. The magnetized metal will point to the north. You can polarize metal electrically with a battery and electric wire. Scrape the ends of the wire bare and coil it around the metal. Touch the bare ends of the wire to the battery terminals. The metal becomes electromagnetic and will point north when suspended. Using the mossy side of a tree to find north is not always accurate. Moss grows completely around some trees. You can survive in enemy territory for an extended time with only a few pieces of equipment, knowledge of basic survival skills, and a strong will to live. When you are faced with survival, continually size up your situation. Consider your needs for first aid, water, shelter, food, fire, and signal. When evading the enemy, security is always your top priority. Survival skills increase your confidence and strengthen your will to live. Practice survival skills before you need to use them. Use them on RTEPs and off-base FTXs. Knowing how to use survival skills before you need them could save your life. Heartbeat, a routine mission can turn into a survival situation in enemy territory. You can find yourself miles from friendly forces with little or no survival equipment, and the enemy is looking for you. With basic survival and evasion skills and a strong will to survive, you can live for days, weeks, or months in any terrain. One of your concerns in a survival situation will be food. When you are moving to evade hostile forces, you expend energy rapidly. The stress of survival saps your energy too. You will need food to fuel your lost energy and to maintain life. In evaluating your need for food in a survival situation, size up your situation. A human with an average amount of body fat can survive up to a month without eating. You should not eat if you don't have water, but prolonged periods without food can seriously weaken you and your will to live. Fatigue, anxiety, and poor judgment can accompany the early stages of food deprivation. Before you find yourself in a survival situation, prepare for the possibility by carrying a personal survival kit on every mission. A few pieces of basic survival equipment can make the difference between living because you can eat and dying of starvation. A knife is an important tool for many steps of food procurement and preparation. Carry something for starting fires. Many animals and plants must be cooked to make them safe to eat. A few feet of 550 cord can be valuable. The small cords inside the shell can be used for fishing and setting traps. When you are evading enemy forces, security is always your top priority. Food procurement should be considered when the tactical situation warrants it and when you need food to keep moving. Take advantage of opportunities for food if they don't jeopardize your safety. You might find berries near a hide site or come across an animal in movement. Other food procurement should be conducted from a secure hole-up site off the lines of drift. There are many sources of food in the wilderness. Pound for pound, meat provides more nutrients than vegetation. With a few exceptions, anything that walks, swims, crawls, or flies can be used for survival food. Even animals already dead, but not completely decomposed, can be eaten when thoroughly cooked. Animals you don't normally associate with eating can save your life in a survival situation. Overcoming aversion to unusual or unappetizing food sources could save your life. Don't wait until you are desperate to eat foods that are not appealing. You will become debilitated, and it may be too late to recover. Take nourishment when it is available, even if the food seems difficult to eat. Insects can be a valuable source of nourishment. Insects are the most abundant life form, are easily caught, and are made up of 65 to 80% protein. Rotting logs lying on the ground are excellent places to look for a variety of insects, including ants, termites, beetles, and grubs, which are beetle larvae. Insects can be seen easily in grassy areas. Stones, boards, and other material on the ground make good nesting sites for insects. Most insects can be eaten raw. However, insects with a hard outer shell, such as grasshoppers, have parasites and should be cooked. Also, remove wings and barbed legs. Disease-carrying insects, such as flies, mosquitoes, and ticks, should not be eaten. Spiders, insects that are brightly colored, hairy, sting, or have an odor, should be avoided. Fish are a good source of protein and fat, and are more abundant than mammals. Fish also are silent when captured. If you are evading, fish are less likely to give away your position than captured animals, which are likely to scream. To fish successfully, you should know the habits of fish. Fish tend to feed heavily before a storm. They are not likely to feed after a storm in muddy, swollen water. Light can attract fish at night. Fish rest in eddies near rocks. Fish gather in deep pools under overhanging brush and around submerged logs or other objects that give them shelter. There are no poisonous freshwater fish. However, catfish species have sharp protrusions on their dorsal fins and barbel that can inflict painful puncture wounds. Some saltwater species are poisonous. Cook all freshwater fish to kill parasites. Saltwater fish caught on a reef or near freshwater should be cooked as a precaution. Saltwater fish caught at sea can be eaten raw because they do not carry parasites. Some amphibians are a good source of food. Frogs and salamanders are easy to find around bodies of fresh water. Frogs seldom move from the safety of the water's edge. When they sense danger, they jump into the water and bury themselves in the mud. There are few poisonous species of frog. Avoid a brightly colored frog or one with a distinct X on its back. Some toads have poisonous skin and should not be handled or eaten. You can distinguish a toad from a frog by its dry, warty skin. Frogs have smooth, wet skin. Salamanders can be found around rocks and mud banks near fresh water. They can range from a few inches to more than 2 feet in length. Frogs and other amphibians should be cooked before eating. Reptiles such as snakes and lizards are a good source of protein and are relatively easy to catch and are tasty. In warm weather, you can find snakes in shade under rocks and logs. In cooler weather, they lie in warm spots in the sun. Poisonous snakes are edible, but should be treated carefully to avoid a bite. Handle all snakes as if they are poisonous. Reptiles should be cooked, but in an emergency, you can eat them raw. Because they are cold-blooded, they don't carry the blood-borne diseases of warm-blooded animals. Avoid the common box turtle. They eat poisonous mushrooms, and the poison can be passed on to you. All species of birds are edible, but must be cooked. As with any wild animal, you must understand birds' common habits to have a realistic chance of capturing them. Birds tend to have regular flyways from the roost to a feeding area and water. Careful observation can show you where flyways are. Roosting sites and water holes are the best places for trapping and snaring birds. Eggs also are a good food source. Remove all but 2 or 3 eggs and mark the ones you leave. The bird will continue to lay more eggs to fill the clutch, and you can continue to take eggs, always leaving the ones you have marked. Mammals are excellent protein sources and the most appealing food source for Americans. All mammals are edible, but must be cooked to destroy blood-borne diseases. You must exercise care when trapping mammals in an evasion situation. The enemy may detect traps or snares on land. Also handle mammals with care. Nearly all mammals will bite in self-defense. In a survival situation, unless a good opportunity to procure large game presents itself, you should concentrate on more abundant small animals. In an evasion situation, when the sound of a gunfire could reveal your position and endanger you, trapping or snaring wild game is preferred for procuring animals. To effectively trap or snare, you must be familiar with the species of animal you intend to catch. You must be able to construct an appropriate trap for the animal you want. And you must not alarm prey by leaving signs of your presence. There is no one trap that is right for all animals. You must determine what species are in a given area and set your traps with those animals in mind. To find out what animals are in an area and where they are, look for runs and trails, tracks, droppings, chewed or rubbed vegetation, nesting or roosting sites, and feeding and watering areas. Position traps and snares where there is evidence of animals. A trail shows signs of use by several species. A run is less distinct and will show signs of one species. In a hostile environment, trap and snare concealment are critical. It is equally important not to alarm the animals and cause them to avoid the trap. Prepare the parts of your trap away from the trap site. Freshly cut vegetation in the area of the trap will alarm the prey. Even the slightest human scent will cause animals to avoid the area. Coat your hands with mud before handling the trap. Fluid from gall and urine bladders of previous kills also masks scents. Do not use human urine. As always, security should be your first priority. Your trap should be well concealed. If you dig, take the dirt out of the area. Also, remember that trapped animals can make considerable noise that can reveal your location. When the trap is set in position, camouflage it as naturally as possible to prevent detection by the enemy and to avoid alarming the prey. Traps or snares placed on a trail or run should use channelization to lead the animals into the trap. To build a channel, construct a funnel-shaped barrier from surrounding natural material. Extend it from the sides of the trail toward the trap, with the narrowest part nearest the trap. As the animal nears the trap, it is unable to turn left or right and will generally not back up. For best results, channelization should reduce the width of the trail to just slightly wider than the targeted animal's body and should be as long as the animal's body. Baiting a trap increases the chances of catching an animal. A baited trap will draw animals to it. The bait should be something the animal is familiar with, but not so readily available that the animal can get it easily nearby. Peanut butter from MREs is a good bait for small animals. Salt is another good bait. Scatter bits of the bait around the trap to give the prey a chance to sample it. The animal will overcome its caution in entering the trap. Traps and snares crush, choke, hang, or entangle the prey. Traps catch and hold, or catch and kill. Snares incorporate a noose to accomplish either function. The power to trap the animal comes from the struggling victim, the force of gravity, or a bent sapling's tension. The heart of any trap or snare is the trigger. When planning a trap or snare, ask yourself how it should affect the prey. What is the source of power? And what will be the most efficient trigger? A simple snare consists of a noose placed over a trail or den hole and attached to a firmly planted stake. The noose should be large enough to pass freely over the animal's head. Wire makes the best noose for a single snare. It is less likely than cordage to slip off the animal's neck. Use a drag noose on an animal run. To make a drag noose, place sticks on either side of the run and lay a sturdy cross member across them. Tie the noose to the cross member and hang it at a height that will pass over the animal's head. As the noose tightens around the animal's neck, the animal pulls the cross member from the forked sticks and drags it along. The surrounding vegetation catches the cross member and the animal becomes entangled. An effective snare is a twitch-up snare. A twitch-up is a supple sapling which, when bent and secured with a trigger, provides power to a variety of snares. A twitch-up snare is relatively easy to conceal. To make a twitch-up snare, find a hardwood sapling that bends and that will support the weight of the animal you want to trap. Bend the sapling to be sure it springs back to an upright position. Don't use soft wood such as pine. They won't spring back after being held down for several hours. Trim the branches from the tree, but don't leave freshly cut vegetation in the area. Mask the freshly cut scent of the tree. Dead but not rotting wood makes a good trigger for any snare. Don't use green wood for a trigger. The sap could cause it to stick together. Notch engaging surfaces on two pieces of wood to make the trigger. Set one piece of the trigger into the ground where the top of the tree will reach it. Make a slip knot in one end of the cordage that is long enough to make a noose. Attach the cord to the top half of the trigger with a secure knot. Make a noose from the slip knot. Prop the noose on small twigs so it hangs over the trail at head height for the animal you are trapping. The twitch-up snare should spring with only a slight tug against the noose. The twitch-up snare will hang the animal. Channelize the trail. The Ojibwa bird pole is a snare used by Native Americans for centuries. The best spot for the Ojibwa bird pole is a relatively open area, away from tall trees. For best results, place it near feeding areas or watering holes. Cut a main pole of non-resinous wood about 6 or 7 feet long. Sharpen the other end to a point. Drill a hole 1 to 3 inches from the top. Square off one side of the hole. Select a stick 4 to 6 inches long and shape it so that it almost fits into the hole. This is the perch. With the pole planted in the ground, pointed end up, tie a weight about equal to the weight of the targeted species to a piece of cordage. Pass the free end of the cordage through the hole and tie a slip noose that will cover the perch. Tie an overhand knot 1 inch behind the noose. Allow the cordage to slip through the hole until the overhand knot rests against the pole and the bottom of the perch. Spread the noose over the perch, making sure it drapes over both sides. When the bird lands, the perch will fall, releasing the overhand knot and allowing the weight to drop. The noose will tighten around the bird's feet. If the weight is too heavy, it will cut off the bird's feet and allow it to escape. A squirrel pole is an effective snare in an area with a lot of squirrel activity. Lean an 8 to 12 foot pole against a tree that squirrels use. Attach several wire nooses along the sides of a long pole so that a squirrel going up or down the pole will have to pass through one or more of them. Position the nooses about an inch off the pole. Put the top and bottom nooses about 18 inches from the top and bottom of the pole to prevent the squirrel from getting solid footing that would allow it to chew through the wire. Squirrels running up and down the pole will get caught in a noose, fall from the pole, and strangle. You can catch several squirrels on the same pole. Use a treadle snare against small game on a trail. Dig a shallow hole in the trail. Then drive the forked end of a stick into the ground on each side of the hole on the same side of the trail. Position two fairly straight horizontal sticks so their ends engage the forks. Tie one end of some cordage to a twitch-up or a weight suspended over a tree limb. Form a noose in the other end that will cover the entire hole and attach the trigger stick. Place the trigger stick against the horizontal sticks and route the cordage between the sticks. Adjust the bottom horizontal stick so that it barely holds the trigger. Place several sticks over the hole so one end is resting on the lower horizontal stick. Because the trap disturbs the trail, animals will be wary. Camouflage and put the noose in place. Channelize the trail. As the animal places its foot on a stick across the hole, the bottom horizontal stick moves down, releasing the trigger and allowing the noose to catch the animal by the foot. A Paiute deadfall drops weight onto the prey and crushes it. Tie one end of a piece of cordage to the lower end of a diagonal stick. Tie the other end of the cordage to another stick about 2 inches long. This is the catch stick. Bring the cord halfway around the vertical stick with the catch stick at a 90-degree angle. Place the bait stick with one end against the drop weight or a peg driven into the ground and the other against the catch stick. When an animal disturbs the bait stick, it falls free, releasing the catch stick. As the diagonal stick flies up, the weight falls, crushing the prey. Be cautious when removing animals from a trap. A cornered animal will fight. Club or spear the animal to kill it before you try to remove it from the trap. A swift death is more humane and reduces your chances of a screaming animal revealing your position. Let's review the key points of food and food procurement in a survival situation. You need food to maintain strength and your will to live. You can survive up to a month without food. Don't panic if you can't eat every day, but don't let yourself become too weak. When evading the enemy, security is your top priority. food procurement should be considered when the tactical situation warrants it, and when you need food to continue movement. Overcome aversion to unusual foods early. It could save your life. Almost anything that flies, crawls, swims, or walks can be eaten. For successful trapping of animals, know their habits. Food is important to survival. It gives you the nourishment you need to keep moving and to make good decisions. It strengthens your will to live, which is your most important ally.
Not bad, Sergeant.